Hello, everyone. My name is Lauren, and I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. It's really good to have you joining us on Zoom tonight for our Artwork on the Lawn Trail workshop. I think this is maybe the sixth one or the seventh one of these that we've done, and they've been a blast. So if this is you returning, then thanks so much for coming back. If this is the first time, then welcome. It's great to have you here. There's two prompts in the screen in front of you. We'd love to know where you're joining from and something you've been doing this winter that's been really fun. So what has been that piece that just kept you going and that you've been able to go to time and time again, or maybe one activity? Maybe you went skydiving or you did a polar plunge in Lake Champlain. So let us know what you've been up to. Those are always exciting, and it's good to share some of our activities. I have a small introduction on the Green Mountain Club, on how Zoom works, and then I'll hand it over to Kati for the main feature of the evening, obviously. If you're new to Zoom, then congratulations on getting through the pandemic until this point. I'm impressed. I'm going to go through a couple quick features. We have the chat box, which is what you all are typing into. A lot of you have figured that out already. If you want to turn your video off, then there's a little button for that. You're all muted when you enter. You do have the power to unmute, but for the purpose of the program, it's great to keep yourselves muted so that we don't hear the dog in the background or something else like that. So do that. At the end, we'll all have a chance to get together and chat if you want to say hi to Kati or anybody else, then that's fine. But let's save that until the end of the program. I think that's all for Zoom. We all know that by now anyways. So the Green Mountain Club. The Green Mountain Club is the organization that founded Vermont's Long Trail. Back in 1910, a bunch of people said, hey, let's build a long distance hiking trail the length of the state. They wanted to connect Vermonters to the mountains. They had experiences on other hiking trails in Vermont and felt that something that really, you know, spanned the Green Mountains and was for all Vermonters would be what that was. The trail is currently 272 miles from the Massachusetts border to the Canadian border. There are 166 miles of side trails, which connect to the Long Trail, 50 miles of the AT, and 50 miles of trail in the Northeast Kingdom. Overall, the GMC has over 25,000 acres of conserved land, which surrounds the Long Trail and that we work to steward as well. The Green Mountain Club runs caretakers and trail crew. There's a couple of photos here of those folks hard at work. And so the caretakers, you know, they are at the backcountry shelters, they're on alpine summits, they're at fragile ponds, and they're preserving the natural resources and the ecosystem of the Long Trail. The Long Trail gets well over 200,000 visitors every single year. And without GMC's caretakers, the trail would not be what it is today. The program is entering its 52nd year of operation, started a long time ago. And Kati is a caretaker, and our caretaker staff are essential to everybody enjoying the trail. Trail crew goes out, they live in the woods for 5 days, they build hiking trails, they build privies, they build shelters, they do all the stuff that keeps it open and keeps it, you know, improving year and year and year again. Shelters and privies, the club maintains 72 overnight shelters and privies along the Long Trail. The shelters, some of them also have tenting areas, they have water sources. The privies are so that we can all go to the bathroom in a sanitary way in the outdoors, really just essential services that the club provides for all that want to use the Long Trail. Last year, we saw increased use of around 35% across the entire trail system. And so that meant that our shelters, our privies, our tenting areas, all were filling up and that they're really in high demand and that the trail is a busy place. And that's good. We want people to go hiking. We want them to connect with the outdoors. We also do trail maintenance and conservation. The trail actually needs to stay open. If we didn't get out there and cut trees away, then they would be falling down like matchsticks all across it. And if anybody hiked through the Breadloaf Wilderness in 2018, you may have experienced that after a big storm. I cut 200 trees in a 2-mile section of trail. So it's a lot of work to keep the trail open. If you wanna do it, if you wanna participate, then send me an email and we can get you out volunteering. Upcoming events. We've had an amazing slate of speakers, the GMC speaker series this year, and also obviously Kati's workshops, which have been really great. Coming up on this Thursday, so 2 nights from now, Rich and Sherry Larson are presenting on a 3-week trip that they took to Newfoundland back in 2019. It's a lot of amazing photos, a lot of amazing geology. Bill McKibben is going to be speaking as part of the Taylor series coming up on Thursday, February 18th, hosted by the Breadloaf section of the Green Mountain Club. If you don't know about Bill McKibben, then check it out. A great opportunity to see Bill. And then next week we have a camping 101 workshop. So a great way to learn how to go winter camping in the little bit of winter that we have left here, how to set up a tent, how to stay warm, how not to freeze, all those things. So all that can be found on our website. Follow the club on social media, check these things out. And it's really good to have you here. If there's any questions, put them in the chat. I can answer those. Otherwise, Kati, I think I can hand these things over to you and we can all start painting.
All right, that sounds great.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you. That talk with Bill McKibben sounds really interesting. I will definitely be going to that one. And the other ones that you've had have been really good too, that I've been to, so.
Yeah, and if,
good job
if
anyone's, with all the events, Lauren.
If anyone's missed the talk, then they're all available on our YouTube page. I can put that link in the chat, but we've had some really amazing speakers, some really good, interesting stories. So I encourage you to check those out and it'll be just like going to the movies, but sitting on your couch.
Always a good time. All right, so welcome everyone to our Zoom painting class today. We are gonna be painting this lovely winter scene that was inspired by a walk I took through the woods last month before it snowed a ton. And I was just seeing like the sun shining through the trees and the shadows that it was creating. And I was like, wow, that would make a great painting. And so now we all get to make this painting together. Materials that you will need and hopefully have. And pretty much all of these are negotiable, like whatever you have, fantastic. If you just have one single ballpoint pen, like awesome. You can still make, you know, something really beautiful tonight. But the materials that I'm gonna be using are watercolor paints. And so this is my very messy palette here. We're not gonna be using all of these colors. We'll be using blue, purple, and yellow, and black, pretty much. I've got my paper, it's taped down. This is actually a block of paper, which is really cool. So it's like all the paper is already like pre-glued together. And so I've just taped the edges so that it has like kind of a nice crisp edge when we're finished with it. And my painting is in a portrait orientation, but this painting would also look great flip sideways. So if you know, would rather paint it in landscape orientation, that's absolutely fine. I've got some paint brushes here. I've got a bigger one for doing the background and then a variety of small and medium brushes for my trees. Masking tape is gonna be super helpful because that is what we're gonna use to create our birch trees. So the first thing we're gonna be doing is taping where we want our birch trees to be so that we can do the rest of the painting on top and then peel the tape off and we'll have nice white trees underneath. So masking tape is gonna be really pretty much essential for that. If you don't have masking tape, you can grab a pencil and just sketch out where you want those trees to be and just be careful painting around it. And that, you know, works absolutely fine. It's kind of fun to like peel off the tape. So masking tape is very helpful. If you have a white crayon, that can be a fun tool. I actually did not use it in this painting. Hi, Michael, glad you're here. But what was I saying? White crayon. So you can actually use this to create some more trees in the background. So crayons are made out of wax and watercolor does not stick to wax. So it'll actually like leave a white tree when you paint over it. So that's cool. If you have a white crayon, awesome. If you don't worry about it. That's just kind of like a fun bonus supply. I've also got some water. Mine is dirty because I've been using it all day. If you have clean water, that's great too. And then I've got a little bandana to dry my paintbrush. So those are all the materials that you'll need. Scissors might be helpful also for just kind of cutting the bottom of your tape to make like a funky shape on your tree trunk, but you can also just tear it and that'll make a lovely shape too. So if you have scissors, I guess I'm using quilting scissors for this. I don't know where my other scissors are. You have scissors, great. Oh, there's my other scissors on the table. If you don't have scissors, don't worry about it. If you don't have watercolors, don't worry about it. You can do pretty much all the same things with crayons, colored pencils, chalk, markers, you know, whatever you've got going on. And if you are using a different material and you have a question about a step, just shoot it in the chat box and I will answer you, and we can figure out how to make your piece of artwork beautiful with different materials. Okay, let's get started. So the first thing that we're going to do is take our masking tape and set out a couple of tree shapes. So in this copy of the painting, I've got three. I did a practice one where I had like seven, and that was kind of too many. So you can just do one if you want, like one really huge birch tree right in the middle. It's totally up to you. And one more thing before we start, I will be leading you through this class, walking you step by step through all these instructions. So if you have never painted before, don't worry about it. If you paint all the time, you can ignore me or listen to me as much as you want to. And if you decide that you need some birds in your trees, or more trees or fewer trees, or a sunset background, or it's your painting, do whatever you want. I'm just here to offer guidance if you want it. And that being said, even if you follow every single step that I give you, everyone's painting is going to be different. So that's the wonderful thing about painting in a group like this. Okay, enough talking. Let's do stuff. So I've got my lovely masking tape here that Santa brought me in my stocking this Christmas. So thanks, Santa, for this lovely masking tape. And I'm basically just going to decide on two or three or four trees. So I'm going to put one right here. And we want to make our trees all different sizes. So the trees in my example, I've got kind of a big one, a real skinny one, and then a medium one. The more different sizes of trees that we have, the more interesting your painting is going to be. So I'm just gonna go, I'll put that over there so you can see. I'm gonna go pretty exactly off of what my kind of master copy was over here. So for this tree on the left, I'm just gonna layer the masking tape next to itself so that I can get kind of a thicker tree. And if you've got scissors and you wanna play with it and get real fancy, you can kind of cut like a fun, funky little shape into the bottom of your masking tape, which I don't know, that's not terribly exciting, but if you want to cut like kind of a squiggle or something so it looks like there's snow sort of wiggling along the bottom of the tree, that's a wonderful thing to do. It's a little bit easier to do that when the tape is still on the roll. I'll do for my next tree. Also, I live in the House of Woods alone and I don't see anyone. So if I'm talking more during this class than in previous classes, it's because I don't see people anymore. Like many of us don't see many people, but I really don't see people. All right, there's that one. And then for my last tree, I'm actually gonna cut some tape in half to make it skinnier. And you'll notice I'm also changing up where the bottoms of my trees are. That makes a more interesting composition and it makes it look like this big tree is closer to you. And then as the trees get smaller and higher up on your paper, the trees are actually receding into the distance. So it's kind of a little trick of the eye. And so when you're thinking about placement, you do want all of your trees to be in the bottoms of the trunks to all be in at least the lower half, mostly the lower third of your painting. If you want to use some leftover tape to make some branches, that's a fun thing that you can do. I've got some skinny tape left over, so I'm gonna just create a lovely branch on this big tree just for funsies. And you can get as fancy as you want with cutting the tape up into fancy shapes and stuff. I'm not gonna worry too much about that. Square that off a little bit. Okay, lovely. So I'll give everybody a minute to finish up putting down some tape trees, and then we will do some painting. So the first thing that we're going to do is create our sun background back here. I did a practice version of this painting yesterday, and I actually did it with a brighter yellow, and I kind of like that better. So that's what I'll be doing, is a bit more of a bright yellow sun. But the way that we're going to do this is start with a medium-sized brush. I'm using a flat brush. If you have a round brush, that's fine. Whatever brush you have, don't worry about it too much. So I'm gonna just get my brush wet with some relatively clean water. And I'm gonna decide where my sun is going to go. So I think that my sun will look cool between these two trees over here. So it's kind of like peeking out. You can put your sun anywhere you want. The only thing that's gonna change with the position of your sun is the direction of your shadows. But we'll talk about shadows when we get to that part. So yeah, I'm gonna do my sun over here. So I'm just gonna take a wet brush and just basically make a circle that's maybe tennis ball sized. I don't know how well you can see the water on the tape. I don't think you can see the water very well on the paper, but just know that I have a circle of water. It's about the size of a tennis ball. And I'm just painting right over the tape. And since we have the tape down, that will protect that part of the paper and it'll stay white. Oh, this would be a good time too. If you have a crayon and want to draw a couple trees on there, you'll want to do that now before we do the rest of our stuff. Yeah, let's do that. If you have a crayon, I'm going to draw just like one tree in the background now so that you can follow along. If you don't have a crayon, ignore this and just take a sip of your tea or whatever you're drinking. So I'm going to say that I want like a real skinny birch tree, just like kind of back here, back on the right-hand side of my painting. So I'm just going to draw a tree with a couple little branches with my crayon. And again, if you don't have a crayon, do not worry about this. You probably cannot even see what I just drew. I can't really see what I just drew. Yeah, that's like barely showing up. But if you want to draw some birch trees with your white crayon, go for it. If you don't have a white crayon, we're moving on to the sun anyway. So I've got my wet circle. Hopefully yours is, mine's a little bit, the water's dirty, so it's a little bit gray. So I've got a wet circle, and then I'm going to pick up some yellow paint off of my palette. All right. If you've done a class with me before, you know what wet into wet painting is. So we've got water on the paper already, and then the paint in our brush is also wet, and we're putting that wet paint onto the wet paper. And so I'm going to start not quite in the center, but very close to the center, and I'm just going to paint a lovely yellow circle. And I'm leaving the center of that circle white just so it looks like a really hot, bright sun. And you'll notice that since the water on the paper is wet and the paint that you're putting into the paper is wet, it's going to start to kind of bleed and pull the color out a little bit, which is really fun. Wet into wet blending is one of my favorite watercolor effects. You can do all sorts of fun stuff with it. Like make a sun. Once you've got the sun done, we're gonna move right on to the sky because I wanna make sure that this the water that the sun has bled into is still wet. So we're going to be using blue for our sky. So I'm using a larger sized brush, just because I've got more area to cover with the blue. And I want to use mostly water. So I've got a fairly wet brush and I'm going to pick up a bit of blue paint. I've got a couple different blues on here. Depending on what your palette looks like, you're going to want whatever your lightest blue is. And I'll just put that on my palette so you can kind of see a little bit what it looks like. Mine's a little bit green because I was painting some green mountains earlier and I'm very messy with my paints. So hopefully yours is not green. So I've got a nice wet brush, some nice blue, and I'm going to start by just going around the outside of my sunny circle. And in the places where it's still wet, like over here, you can see it's already started to kind of bleed in a little bit and get that really nice blendy effect. Over on this side, the water had already dried, so I'm just gonna kind of dry off my brush a little bit and just gently go right along that edge where it is a little bit kind of a hard edge and just sort of soften it up a bit. Great. Then what I'm gonna do is just take my fairly washed out color. We're going to call this a wash, or this is called a wash. We're not just deciding it. So it's mostly water with some pigment in it. And I'm going to decide where my ground line is. So it's going to be a bit below halfway up the painting. And I'm just going to kind of create sort of a wiggly, not like super wiggly, but just sort of a soft wavy line. And that is where my ground and my sky meet, my horizon line. And then I'm just gonna fill in everything above that with my blue. Ooh. You can see I've got my white birch tree over here on the edge, and that's kind of popping a little bit. So that's a cool, fun effect. Now, as you're doing this, you want to make sure that your brush isn't like super saturated, soaking wet. You don't really want to have like puddles of water forming on your painting, because you do want it to be able to dry in a fairly timely manner. And if you are noticing puddles, like if your brush was very wet, like I've got a puddle forming right here, what I'm going to do is just dry off my brush a bit, and then I can just put the dry brush and it's actually going to just kind of soak up some of that extra water. So if you've got any puddles forming, you can just go back over them with a more dry brush or even dab it a bit with a paper towel. That's my sky. I've got my lovely sun sort of radiating out. Looks like that watery, cold afternoon winter sun. All right, whenever you've got your sky finished, we're gonna go on and do some stuff in the snow. So since we've got this lovely yellow sun, it's casting that gorgeous kind of late afternoon, like low sun glow onto the snow. And so we're actually gonna paint our snow just like a pale buttery yellow. And I know that my light is not great, but hopefully you can see that the snow is a bit yellow and not perfectly white. So we're gonna be doing another wash on the snow. And so again, that's just a very washed out color. So we're basically just staining the paper. We're not necessarily painting a super strong color on it. So I've rinsed out my brush and I'm gonna pick up some yellow. I've got some water in the brush. It's not like dripping wet, but there's definitely water in the bristles, and I'll pick up some yellow. And then I'm just gonna paint the entire snow this lovely washed out yellow. And I'm again using my larger brush. I'm gonna try to not let my sky and my ground bleed into each other too much. If it does, that is not a big deal because we will be painting a bunch of trees and shadows and all sorts of fun things. But I'm just trying to be pretty careful when I'm right along that edge between the ground and the sky. I'm just filling in all of my snow with my lovely pale yellow wash. And just like before, we don't want to have, you know, huge puddles of water. So we've got a wet brush, but it's not, you know, we're not just like slopping watery paint on here. We're being a little bit careful with it. And if it does get super wet, you can take your rag or your paper towel or even just a dried out brush. And again, you can just kind of soak up some of that puddle with your brush. You can also just use your fingers like I'm doing right now. Not the recommended technique, but it works in very small areas if you need it to. So in just a moment, we will start on our trees. There are a lot of trees in this painting. You know that people sometimes get a little bit anxious about trees, but I think that trees can be really meditative once you kind of like drop into it and figure out how trees work. They're really fun. So the first trees that we'll be doing are these like super distant background trees back here, these really kind of faded out gray ones. And that's just our distant forest. So I'm going to be using my medium-sized brush for those. I've got my medium-sized flat brush. It's called flat because it is flat. Mine's a little bit curved because it sits in the water a lot, but it's kind of a squared off flat brush. Yes, so the way that we will be getting that effect is, again, almost a wash. We're gonna be using a little bit more pigment than for our background colors, but I've still got a fairly wet brush. And then I'm just gonna pick up a bit of black. I'm gonna work it into my bristles, maybe add a bit more water. So I've got, here we go. So it's about that, that strength and consistency. It's like a pretty light gray that we're going for here. So when you've got that light gray sorted out, then we're going to make our background trees. And we want these to be maybe 2.5 inches tall-ish, give or take. Trees are more interesting when they're not all exactly the same. So it's fun to have some be a little bit taller and some be a little bit shorter. And so as we do that, I'm going to start by just basically scribbling the top of my trees. So That's one of the advantages of the flat brush, is that I can just use kind of this flat end. And basically I'm just doing like a squiggly line, and that creates a really lovely treetop effect. You can get this exact same effect with any kind of paintbrush, just depending on how you use it. So I'm going to go the trees are taller over here, and then they're going to get a little bit shorter. Lovely scribblies all the way across my painting. If anyone joining me was here for our very first Art on the Long Trail workshop, where we painted the most beautiful place in Vermont, Stratton Pond. This is a very similar technique to how we made the background trees on the other side of the pond. After I've made my scribbly line, I'm just filling in everything below those trees until I reach my snow line. And for my artwork on the Long Trail super fans out there, you know I couldn't let a workshop go by without mentioning how wonderful Stratton Pond is. It is wonderful.
Kati, are you going to come to Hugh and Jean's to choose?
Yes, absolutely. I'm very excited for that one.
Folks, Stratton Pond sits next to Stratton Mountain. And at Stratton Mountain, there's a fire tower on top, and there's a cabin that goes along with the fire tower. And these two folks, Hugh and Jean Jowdry, they have been the caretakers of the Stratton Mountain Fire Tower cabin for 52 years. They go up every single summer. They live in the cabin for the entire summer, and they talk to people that come up to the fire tower. And so March 25th, they'll be presenting on what it's like to, you know, see 52 years on top of Stratton Mountain. Should be really cool. And Hugh and Jean are great to visit. If you're lucky, Jean might give you a glass of wine. She'll definitely give you some cookies. And oh, yes. Hugh will tell you lots and lots of stories. So it's going to be a good presentation.
They are great. The year that I was the Stratton Pond caretaker, I would go up a couple times a month, run up to the top of the mountain and visit with them. And I'd plan to be there for like an hour. And then 3 hours later, I'd be like, oh my goodness, sun is setting. I have to go. They're wonderful. And yeah, they have a wealth of stories. So that'll be a great presentation. Okay, great. Hopefully we've got our background trees set in there nicely. And now it looks like a distant forest. So what we're gonna do next is make some shadows for our big trees. Now this is my favorite part of the painting. I think the shadows are really cool. And it's a fun way. We just get to think about light and shadow and yeah. So the way that we're gonna create these shadows is we have to remember what's casting the light and what's blocking the light, right? So we've got our sun right here, and that is what is casting the light into our forest towards us. So basically we're gonna imagine that there's a dot in the center of our suns, and hopefully we've got, you know, a little bit of white that didn't have any paint in it, and you can kind of use that as the center of your sun. That's gonna be where the light is coming from. So it's gonna come like from here and then hit my tree. And then that means that the shadow is going to be cast at like this kind of an angle here. So one way that I like to do shadows and make them like kind of accurate and look like what they're supposed to look like is I use a different paintbrush, and I just put one end of it in the center of my sun. And then I put the other end of it in the center of the bottom of my tree trunk, like so. And then that is actually the angle that my shadow is going to be leaving the tree at. And so we'll be doing that for all of our trees, and you don't have to like get the paintbrush out for every single tree, but at least for starting out, I find that really, really helpful. So if you have a spare paintbrush, if you have a pencil, a ruler, you know, your friend's arm, like whatever is gonna work for you, that's what we'll be using to figure out where our shadows are going to be. Thanks, Mike J. All right, so the color of our shadows is gonna be a mixture of blue and purple. So I've actually still got some blue leftover for my sky on my palette. So I'm just going to use that because, you know, reduce, reuse, recycle. It's great. I'm using my medium sized brush, whatever that may be for you. And I'm just going to grab some purple and mix that in with my blue. If you don't have any blue left over on your palette, basically we're just going to mix some blue and some purple together. And it's a little bit too purple still. Oh, now we're getting there. And it is ultimately up to you to decide what color you like, but I like it to be a bit more on kind of the blue side of the bluey purpley spectrum. And that is a super technical term for you all. So that is what the color looks like. Again, I'm sorry, my lighting is not amazing. If we were doing this at 2 p.m, I'm facing a window, so we'd have great light, but alas, many people have jobs. And not alas, it's great that you have jobs, but that makes it difficult to paint together at 2 p.m. Anyway, maybe we'll do Saturday sometime. So that's the color I'm going for, is kind of a blue purple mixture. And again, this is a somewhat washed out color because I don't want it to be like, bam, super strong, like a purple line across my painting. I want it to be a little bit more subtle than that. So I'm gonna start with my tree over here. I've got my paintbrush telling me where my shadow is going to be. All right, so the shadow is kind of coming off at this angle, and I'm just gonna remember that. It's gonna look like that. Another technique I use so that I don't have to have a brush on the paper the whole time is I just kind of hover my brush like an inch or so above, doesn't matter how far, but an inch or so above my paper. And then I kind of like direct it from the sun to the tree. And then I put my brush down when I get to the tree. And so then I'm gonna take this shadow, go all the way to the edges of my tree trunk. And there we have the shadow. Shadows are fun. A couple things to keep in mind about trees and shadows. Once we're painting our trees, this will matter more, but trees tend to be wider at the base and get narrower as they go up because they are growing up. And so they're, you know, it's a little skinnier part growing up and they've got a strong solid base. Shadows kind of do the opposite. So the shadow is actually going to be the most narrow at the base of the tree. And then because of like light distortion and physics and I don't know, science, it's going to get a little bit wider as it goes out away from the tree. And this isn't something that you really need to like exaggerate a ton in your painting, but it's just something to keep in mind a little bit. And if you want to just make it one width the entire way down, that is absolutely fine too. But if it, you know, happens to get a little bit wider, then that's fine. So I'm going to go on to my next one. Like with this tree, I will start with kind of a lighter pressure on my brush. And then as I get closer to the bottom of the paper, I'll just push a little bit harder, which makes the bristles splay out just a little bit, which will naturally just kind of make my shadow be a little bit wider as we go down. Last shadow. One more thing to keep in mind is don't stress out too much about these shadows, because I can guarantee you that, like, you know, unless your, you know, annoying brother is doing this class with you, nobody's going to be going up to your painting when it's finished, like with a paintbrush, like, oh, is that shadow the exact right angle? Like, no, nobody cares. I mean, we care, but, you know, nobody's going to be criticizing you about that. So if your shadow turns out a smidge wonky, don't worry about it. We're just doing this to have some fun. That's what art is about, is having fun and being creative and just kind of expressing what you're feeling and what you're seeing. And what I'm feeling right now is that I'm very happy to be living in Vermont and seeing scenes like this in the woods every day. All right, so what we're going to be doing next is painting more trees. We're going to have kind of two more layers of trees going on in our background here. So we've got some kind of skinnier, further away trees that are going to be a bit lighter. And then we've got these stronger, darker trees that are going to be in front. It is up to you how many trees you paint. If you want like just these three birch trees, you can just chill out and drink your wine while the rest of us paint all these trees. If you want to paint a whole deep, dark forest, go for it. I'm going to paint kind of a, you know, a young new growth forest, because that's what some of the woods look like where I live. So I'm basically just going to be using black paint and some water and a smaller brush. You can decide how small of a brush works for you. If you've got a spare piece of paper and you want to do a couple of practice trees before you jump onto your painting, that's, you know, a wonderful thing to do if you're feeling a little bit unsure about trees. And also, we're going to be painting so many trees that these first few are basically practice trees anyway, that are going to be in the background and that aren't, you know, they're going to be covered up. So if you paint a tree in the background and you fall in love with it, try not to do that. Don't fall in love with your first couple trees. And if you do, wonderful, we'll paint around it. I'm right-handed, so I'm just going to start at the left side of my painting. And to make a tree, I like to start at the bottom. Again, trees are wider at the bottom and thinner as they go up. So I'm going to start with more pressure on my brush and kind of drag a line upwards. And as I go up, I'm going to lift my brush up so that I'm using kind of more the tip of the brush. Oh, and that is so washed out, you can't see it at all. I'm going to add a bit more color into this one. Hopefully you can see it. Now, again, when we're making trees and forests, the more variety that we have in our trees, the better. So this one doesn't quite go to the top of the painting. It's a little bit wiggly. That's fun. I'm just going to square off the bottom a little bit. And then I'm also going to give this tree a couple of branches, because branches are fun and trees are not just straight stalks. So when I paint branches, I like to think about driving off of an exit on the highway. So exits on the highway are not right angles. They're just these like lovely kind of curves. So I start with my brush in my tree. Okay, all right, I'll do this so you can see in my tree, and then ooh, I'm taking the exit and off we go. So it's kind of a nice curve. It's still, you know, moving, growing upwards towards the light, because that's what branches do. And you can put as many or as few branches on your trees as you want. And then we're just going to do that over and over and over again, kind of across the whole paint. So maybe my next tree will be almost at the very top of my snow line, and it's going to be a real skinny little fella. And then we go about that tall, and then we'll just have a couple branches. Another skinny one over here. As we are painting trees, the only thing to really keep in mind is that when we get to the sun is so strong and so bright, we're kind of going to create that like effect of the glare in a photograph. So if you can see in my master copy here, I've got some trees that go up and they kind of taper out when they get to the sun, and then they continue once they go back above the sun. So I'll show you that on my painting here. So I'll have a tree that starts here. And then when I get into the sun, it's just going to kind of fade away. But I want it to continue after the other side of the sun. And so that gives us, you know, like a kind of like a glare effect. If you're taking a photo, the sun would kind of wash out those spindly little trees right in front of it. And if you're like, Kati, that is, you know, I'm at my wit's end here just painting trees, like, paint your trees over the sun, that's fine. This is just a fun effect to play with if you want to. Just changing up where on the snow the trees all start. The more variety we have, the better. And if you're finding that it's really difficult to get like a nice taper, just switch down to a smaller brush. I like giving my trees some wiggles. These are trees in the forest. They've got a tough life. They live through winter in Vermont or New York or Minnesota or, you know, anywhere that has tough winters. So they might have gotten kind of blown around in the wind. When I'm hiking through the woods and I see trees that have like fallen over but then continue to grow up, I call them dancing trees because they look like they're dancing and I like them. I'm also going to make sure to create some like really skinny trees that are basically just one line kind of here way out in the back. I'm not stressing too much about any of these little guys. Cool, so that's my first layer of forest. And what I'm gonna do next is the same exact thing, but bigger and bolder. So I might use the same brush, you might switch up to a bigger brush depending on what size you've got. I'm gonna use more pigment and less water for these so that my black is a stronger, bolder black. And basically I'll just be making some bigger, more detailed trees in the foreground. So this guy is still a little bit wet over here. So I'll start with a few on kind of the middle of my painting. Same thing, I want them to be wider at the base and then get skinnier as they grow up. I can achieve that effect by just pushing harder with my brush at the bottom of the tree than at the top of the tree. And you can also go back in and widen up the base if you know, you sneezed while you were painting the top of the tree and your brush smushed onto the paper. You're like, oh no, it's the wrong size. Well, no, it's not. Painting, we can fix it. But that one, ooh, it's kind of bleeding into the tree behind it. That's a fun effect. Not something I was intending, but I think it looks cool, so I'm gonna leave it. If there is a tree in your background that you're like, that is the best tree anyone has ever painted, make sure that you don't paint one of these bigger, blacker trees over top of it. Leave that beautiful background tree to shine. I don't know about you folks, but I find painting trees and forests and things like this where I don't really have to, I'm not really following like a reference photo, I'm just kind of making it up. I find this really meditative. You can just hear the swish of the brush on the paper. And I really, there's no way to mess it up. But it's just whatever is in your heart is coming out onto your paper. Don't be afraid to have those branches really crisscross and overlap each other and overlap your taped on birch trees and have them go right off the edge of the paper. That again makes your forest more interesting. Remember to keep in mind that you want your trees starting at different places on the bottom of your paper and ending at different places. You want to keep it interesting, keep it fresh. At this point, I'm pretty happy with where my forest is. It's gotten, I got pretty excited about painting all of my trees. And I think that's enough. But I will just let you folks keep working on those trees for a few more minutes. And then we'll be working on shadows next. So if you are finished with your trees and you are ready to just like jump into shadows, we're just going to be doing the same exact thing to make shadows that we did before. I'm going to hold off and just kind of wait until everybody's ready. But if you're just like, if the artistic genius is coursing through you, be my guest, paint some beautiful shadows.
Kati, Sue has said that she just discovered the fun of the crayon tree.
Oh yeah. It is fun.
That's great.
I'm guessing, Sue, you made some trees with crayons in the beginning. Crayons are actually a really wonderful tool that you can use in watercolors. And I haven't been doing that in a while, but I just bought like a bunch of white crayons off of eBay because you can't buy just one crayon. They send you like 50. So if anybody wants a white crayon, hit me up, mail it to you. I've got 12, not 50, but still. Any color crayon works for this. So if you want to paint like a fall scene and just like kind of go to town scribbling with colors for a while and then paint trees on top of it, that would be fun. It's fun for an art project if you want to like write something like your name or live, laugh, love or let's hike today or like whatever and then kind of paint behind it. It'll resist the paint and look really cool. So crayons, not just for kindergartners, crayons are for everybody. I'm going to move on and get started on some more shadows. So we do have some like distant background shadows to make for this like really background layer of trees. So I'm gonna do that first. And that's gonna be rather sketchy. I think I did it better in this version of the painting actually. So like the first, you know, inch and a half or so of your forest is basically just going to be your shadow color, and then the shadows from the rest of your trees will pop out from that. So I'm basically just going to try to mix up the same color that I had before, more or less. So again, that's water and blue and purple. Ooh, not that much blue. A little bit more purple in there. Fun tip, you have a blank piece of paper, you can try out your shadow color or any color that you're working with on that paper first. So yeah, I like that. That's pretty good. So for my background shadows, I'm basically just going to be, again, keeping in mind which direction the sun is coming from. So the sun is coming from kind of this direction, sort of from the upper right. So my shadows, at least at the start, are going to kind of head off towards the left. So for my distant background shadows, I'm really just going to be carefully painting in between my trees and then kind of roughing up the edge of that, right? Basically the same thing that we did for the top of the trees. Kind of filling it in and then making some, you know, little tops of the trees that are going to be coming out from there. And we didn't do this step before the trees, because then we would have had to paint our background trees that much of a stronger pigment. And I like doing them really light. That's why we do have to kind of paint around the trees that we've already got a little bit, which is a smidge annoying, but I know that you can all handle it. Again, kind of a nice meditative little thing to do. And if your trees are dry, it's okay if your shadow color overlaps them a little bit. It's not going to hurt anything. I'm not painting over my trees on purpose, but if it happens, it's okay. And that tree's wet, so I'm going to skip that little section. Again, this is just the background, the shadows of those background trees that we did way long ago at the beginning. Oops. If one of your trees is still wet and it starts to bleed into your forest, you can just take a dry brush and soak that up. So that is my background forest shadow finished. And then from there, I'm just going to go and pick out the important trees, depending on how many trees you made. If you made like 100 trees, you can, but you don't have to paint 100 shadows. But just kind of pick out which are the important trees and paint those shadows. And again, we're going to use that same technique of figuring out where the light is coming from and where it's going to go. Create those lovely shadows. And you want to make sure that that shadow does meet up with the bottom of your tree, all the way across the base of the trunk of the tree. Because shadows don't float unless you are Peter Pan and your shadow has escaped you. But these trees are just regular trees. They're not magical lost boy trees. Some of your shadows are gonna kind of meld into one another, and that's fine and lovely. And if you have branches, you can paint shadow branches. For the most part, my branches are higher up, and just based on the composition, they're not gonna show up in this bottom part of the shadow. But if you have some lower branches, go ahead and paint shadows of those branches too. That's such a fun effect. I love it. Everybody take another little bit to finish up your shadows. And then we'll be moving on to some details in our birch trees. Don't want to rush you. It looks like most folks' heads are still down working on those shadows. So give me another minute or two. All right, so I hope that you're all ready for the coolest part of this painting, which is when we peel off our tape and we see our beautiful clean white birch trees. Be careful, take your time. Don't just like rip the tape off, because depending on the quality of your tape, that might tear your paper and that would be very sad. So just take your time. I just cut my fingernails today, so this is gonna be difficult. I was not thinking when I did that. Okay. Oh, so cool. Whoa. And I did get a little bit of a tear there, but that's okay. I can mend that real quick. Oh, that was fun.
That is immensely satisfying, Kati.
Isn't it great?
Mm-hmm.
I was so excited when that idea struck me in the woods. I was like, oh yes, it's gonna be the best class yet. If you have a cat, you can ball up this tape and toss it on the floor and they will have fun batting it around. If you don't have a cat, you can reuse the tape or throw it away, or whatever you do with your tape is your personal business. All right, so we've got two steps to add some details into our trees, and then that's the end of the painting. So what we're gonna do is create a bit of a subtle shadow on our tree. I'm not sure how well you can see it in the video, but if you go back to the event sign up page, this picture is much clearer. It was photographed in daylight. That helps. So you'll see there's a subtle shadow. So we're going to do that with wet into wet blending, my favorite. So I'm going back to my medium sized brush. I'm getting it wet, making sure there's no purple left in it. If there is, that's not the end of the world, but yeah, So I've got a wet brush, and what I'm going to do first is just put water on the whole birch tree. So just like the sun, we want it wet, but not like puddling wet. We just want that paper to be damp enough to pull some paint around for us. And I painted a branch, gave myself a little extra work, so I'm also getting that branch wet. I'm doing one tree at a time, because water does have a tendency to dry, especially in these dry indoor heating winter months. All right, so again, we are thinking about where our light is coming from. The light is shining onto this tree, so my shadow is going to be on the left-hand side of the tree. So I've got my brush wet. I'm going to pick up a bit of black, watered down black paint. So I've got just like a nice gray. And then what I'm going to do is take that and just go down the left-hand side of my tree. Whoa. It's bleeding a little bit. I want it to bleed a little bit more. So I'm just going to clean off my brush. And with a clean, slightly damp brush, I'm just going to go down the edge of that watercolor, and it's going to start pulling that that darker color towards the other side of the tree a little bit more. Sometimes this is something you can do with one stroke, and sometimes it requires a little bit of finessing. But basically, I just want a subtle shadow and a subtle highlight. Another fun thing you can do, since it's watercolor, is you can kind of tip it up a little bit, and gravity will pull a bit of that pigment down across the tree for you. That's a really fun technique to play with if you have some time and are feeling artistic some other time. It's just mess around with colors on a piece of paper. It's cool. I put my shadow on the top of my branch here. That is where the light is coming. Cool, so we've got just like a nice subtle shadow. And then I'll do that on, oh, and you can't see it at all. It's super washed out. Move the light. Well, hopefully it's showing up better in your paintings. You can kind of see it now that the light's gone. Trust me, it looks nice. And I'm sure it looks very nice in your paintings too. I'm gonna go ahead and do my next tree. Again, just taking some clean water, getting that whole trunk damp. And get some gray. So just some black and water. And depending on your paint sets, some of you might have a gray paint, in which case use it, that's awesome. And if you want your birch trees to have orange shadows, that's cool too. It is your painting, you do whatever you want to do. Just be careful dragging the shadow down the side of the tree that is not facing the sun. For my last tree, the shadow is going to be on the other side because it is on the other side of the sun. Whoa. And this one, I'm going to tip my paper up and let gravity do a little bit of work here for me. I don't know how well you can see that, but it's kind of, that's actually a really cool effect. And it does look kind of birch tree-ish, just the way that the paint is moving. Yeah, that's not showing up well on camera. But the way the paint is moving is kind of in a not super even pattern. It's a little bit more interesting. And then the last thing that we'll do is add those details into our trees. Mine are still all just a little bit damp, I think. Yeah. Just a little bit damp. So I'll give those a minute to dry if you're not sure if something on your painting is wet, you can actually pick it up and just kind of move it around, sort of facing a light source. And if you notice that some part is shiny, that means that it's still wet. You can also gently feel it with your fingers or your hands. I like to use kind of like the, I guess that's the backs of my fingers. And if it feels cold and wet, it is still wet. All right, so for our last birch tree details, I'm going to be using my smallest brush. This is a size 3, I guess. Maybe that's an 8. I don't know, it's little. It's a small brush, nice for doing details. And we'll just be painting these fun like zebra stripes on our birch trees. So there's a few different ways we can achieve these effects, and I will show those to you as soon as my tree is dry. But it's nice, just like, you know, everything in this painting, we like to have some variety. So you don't wanna just paint like even zebra stripes all the way across your tree, because then that's not gonna be very exciting. So we like to mix it up, have some strokes go all the way across, some be shorter. And then I also really like doing these little like spirally knots. I don't know that it's the most realistic way to paint a birch tree, but I think it's a fun way to paint a birch tree. And that's what we're here to do, is have fun, darn it. All right, that's dry enough. So got my little brush, picking up some black paint. And at this point, we're finally not doing a wash anymore. So I want this to be some fairly saturated black paint. So I will have to keep, you know, jumping back to my palette pretty often to pick up more paint because there's not a lot of water in it. Okay, so we're all nice and dry. If you want to pull up a picture of a birch tree on your phone, or if you have a book or something that you want to follow, awesome. I like to just kind of make it up as I go. So basically I'm just starting from one side of the tree. I'm going to give my strokes a bit of a curve. Ooh, fun. And like I said before, they're not all going to be the same, same weight, right? So this first stroke, I made that by taking my brush and using kind of like the whole thing, right? So a lot of times for details, we use just the very tippy top of the brush, but for this one, I was actually pushing kind of the entire edge of the brush. So I'll do another stroke like that across. And then I can kind of vary, right, how much of my brush I'm pushing down on. So I've got my brush kind of laid, not quite, but almost parallel to the paper rather than being kind of upright like this. And as I drag it across the paper, I can kind of vary the angle that I'm pushing down at, and that gives me that fun kind of barky texture. And then I can also just kind of make it up. Whoa. You can also paint some branches coming off of your birch tree. Unless the branches are really big. Branches on birch trees don't usually do like the papery thing. You know, the smaller branches are actually more black. So we can make like a little branch here that comes in towards the top. I'm gonna round off the bottom of it. And then a fun thing that we can do is create kind of like a concentric ring spiral sort of effect around the bottom of a branch. And again, I don't know that that's like the most realistic way to paint a birch tree, but I think it looks cool. And you all knew that it was a birch tree, regardless of if it's perfectly realistic or not. And since I've got this big branch, I'm gonna do kind of a bigger version of that effect. And this is basically what we are doing for the rest of our painting. If you make a stroke on your birch tree and you're like, oh no, that one's weird, just keep making more strokes. Because again, once you've got your birch tree like all filled in with these lovely stripes, that one weird stripe is not gonna stand out at all. And maybe it'll turn out that you actually really like that weird stripe. as we're doing this, it's also good to leave some parts of your trunk that don't have a lot of stripes. Again, for that nice visual interest, we want to make this painting exciting and interesting to look at. And so we don't want it to be super even everywhere. Some spots are gonna have more stripes, some are not gonna have as many stripes. I'm always remembering to curve my strokes to follow the shape of that tree. I'm varying the weight. I really hope that maybe sometime this summer or fall, we can do one of these classes in person. And I know then all of you wouldn't be able to come, but maybe we could do like a hybrid thing, or just a small class with some people in person. That'd be really fun.
I would enjoy that, Kati. I think if folks in the crowd think they could show up somewhere in Vermont, whether Northern Vermont or Southern Vermont, if you wanted to participate, then send me a message or something. I think that we'll be able to, you know, get together sitting outside around a bunch of picnic tables. No problem.
I would like that a lot. I worked at a paint bar for a while in a previous part of my life. And one of my favorite parts was going around and seeing, like looking over everybody's shoulders and seeing what everyone was making. And just kind of being inspired by the people in the class. Cause a lot of them, you know, were just there for a bachelorette party or their anniversary or girls' night out or something fun. They weren't, you know, they weren't artists, but they were creating art. So that made them artists, but they weren't artists before they showed up. But a lot of times they'd come up with some really interesting things in their paintings. And it was really cool to kind of see that and get to know people, help them out with their paintings in person. And yeah,
Kati, it would almost be awkward to do it in person as opposed to on Zoom at this point. I'm so used to this now.
I know, you can't just turn your camera off and wander away. You have to like be, not that you're doing that, but I mean, you know, for anybody.
Yeah.
I think we've all kind of gotten used to being like, oh, well, I want to take a bite of my dinner that I'm eating while we're doing this, so I'll turn my camera off. Whatever it is. Maybe when we do it in person, we can all bring dinner and eat together. I love dinner. Also breakfast. Lunch is annoying because lunchtime is when I'm like really getting into my art. I'm like, oh, darn it, I'm hungry. I have to stop painting.
Or if you're out stirring somewhere and you're like, oh, I gotta stop and eat lunch.
Oh, yeah. I could just do this for 3 more hours, but no. I have to eat. I knew we couldn't let the whole class go by without talking about privies a little bit. Cool. So I have finished my painting now. If you are still working, go ahead and keep on working as long as you want to. Whenever you do get to the end of your birch stripes, I don't know, does anybody know if those have a more technical term? The black stripes on a birch tree?
Some of them are lenticels.
Are what?
Some of them are called lenticels. They're for
lenticels.
Yeah, they allow the bark to exchange gases, but I don't think everything on a birch is called that.
Well, that is such a fun fact. Thank you. So when you're done painting your lenticels and other stripedy parts of the tree, the last step is to sign it. So you can do that with a pencil or with your paintbrush. I like to use a color that's already in the painting. So I'm just mixing up a bit of a purpley blue here. I like to do my initials in the lower left-hand side of my painting. Picasso and Monet would sign with their whole last name. Some people like to sign on the back. It is totally up to you, but it is important that you sign your work so that you know that you did it. And in the future, people can look at this and be like, oh, wow, a Michael Dillon original. This is worth millions. And of course, I screwed up the K on my name. That'll happen. Now it just looks like it's wearing bell bottoms. And then when you're all done, you can peel off the tape around the edges, and that's almost as fun as the birch tree tape.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Yeah, Kati, thank you so much. This is wonderful. Everyone out there, if you've pulled off your tape, what we've been doing is, if you want to hold your painting up to the camera, like you put your view on gallery view. Let's see. Great. We should all be able to see each other. Nice.
These are beautiful.
Very cool.
Oh my goodness gracious.
Look at all you Picassos and Monets out there.
Wow. What a true group of artists.